Good evening, everyone. We'll call the meeting to order. Joy, would you please call the roll?
Flournoy.
Here.
Hallie.
Yes.
Anderson.
Yes.
Rasmussen.
Yes.
Hamilton.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Council, any additions or changes to this evening's agenda? If not, we'll move to our consent agenda. Several items, approval of minutes from the February 27th council meeting. We have payroll in the amount of $117,775.40 for March 10th. Mike, are we on the special payroll amount? Has that been clarified?
I would ask council to table that amount for tonight. That amount is actually twice what it should be. That was found this afternoon, so Denise is working to correct that amount. We'll bring a new amount back to council for consideration at the next meeting.
Okay, thank you. Mayor. So we'll just eliminate that from the consent agenda. Approval of the February finance report. We have a resolution for employment from within the Park and Rec Department, several in that category. We have a resolution of employment in the Street Department for Cameron Rinneberger. I think it is Cameron? Rinneberger. Cameron, I think when we're done with the consent agenda, if you could just come up and introduce yourself, that'd be great. Let's see. We have resolution of employment for a part-time fire department personnel, Robert Lathrop, and approval of liquor license for Pizza Hut and the Quick Stop. We have approval of claims in the amount of $1,335,814.63, of which you have your two largest, both associated with our sewer improvements, so $390,189.06 to Lang Construction and $671,188.41 to SM Pentages and Sons. Any questions regarding those consent agenda items, Council? Not entertain a motion to approve.
Move for approval.
Moved by Hamilton.
Second.
Second by Rasmussen. Please call the roll.
Hamilton.
Yes.
Rasmussen.
Yes.
Hallie.
Yes.
Anderson.
Yes.
Flournoy?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. So Cameron, if you'd just come up and introduce yourself. Yes, that'd be great.
My name is Cameron Rinneberger.
Tell us where you're from and what your background is.
I'm a current resident here at Fairfield. I've lived here all my life. I went to UNI for college and got my business management degree. And looking to start a career here at the City Works Department.
Great, fantastic. We welcome you and wish you a lot of luck and many years with us. So,
thank you.
Thanks very much. Hey, next council, we'll move to our resolutions, action items, and ordinances. We have several public hearings to set to begin with. The first is a petition to rezone. And that is from B2 to a business district PUD, plan unit development, and that is with the neighborhood builders and developers. We're going to be talking about that development as well. So in regards to that, there are two issues. One would be the rezoning, and the other is the approval of the zoning for the development itself. So we'll take the first one, which would be the rezoning. That would be at our next meeting, March 27th. So motion to approve the public hearing setting.
So moved.
Moved by Flournoy, second by Hamilton. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed, same sign. And then setting the public hearing for the planned unit development itself for neighborhood builders and developers, March 27th.
So moved.
Moved by Anderson.
Second.
Second by Hamilton. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed, the same sign. And then we have a public hearing for the consideration of a final plat for the Lincoln Court subdivision, also coming out of planning and zoning. So that'll be at our next meeting as well, March 27th. Motion to approve.
Move to approve.
Second.
Moved by Hamilton. Second by Flournoy. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, the same sign. Okay, thanks. We also will be setting a public hearing for our annual nuisance abatement assessments. As you know, we take a look at the list of those abatements that had, or those had fines that have not been paid over the year, and we assess those to the property taxes. So we'll set that public hearing for March 27th as well.
So moved.
Moved by Anderson.
Second.
Second by Flournoy. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, the same sign. Thank you. Our next action item would be to enter into a rebate incentive agreement with Alliant Energy for some of the equipment and things that we're going to be putting into the wastewater treatment plant. Mike, this is kind of a no-brainer, foregone, so if we could just explain to the council what we're actually approving here.
Sure, thank you, Mayor. So yeah, this is usually we're spending money here, we're getting it back. As a part of the construction process at the wastewater treatment plant, we're putting in a number of energy-saving devices, from variable frequency drives to LED lighting, to efficiencies in our oxidation ditches and the primary clarifier. So right now, the estimated custom rebate amount from Alliant is $26,400. And again, that is contingent upon the installation of all of those energy-efficient products. So that could go up, could go down. Alliant will verify the installation once it's complete and then issue us a rebate check based on what we actually install.
Okay, so this is an agreement that will list all of those different items.
That's correct, Mayor.
Okay. Council, entertain a motion to approve the agreement with Alliant Energy for rebates.
Move to approve.
Moved by Rasmussen.
Second.
Second by Anderson. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, the same sign. Okay. Thank you. Council, looks like we're going to get an update from Melanie French Reneker about our projects that are going on and several change orders. So, Melanie, go ahead. You'll give them to us in a synopsis, and then we'll take each of them one by one.
So I want to break them into both contracts. And first, I'll start by talking about SM Hintage's contract. Those are your next four action items. SM was the contractor for the section of pipe from the wastewater treatment plant to Lamson Woods. To put it to perspective, if I can find my quick notes here, the original contract amount was around $3.6 million, which was approximately $900,000 lower than the second low bid. You see your action items start with change order number three, and change orders one and two are relatively minor. They were total between the two of them was $16,021.08. So they were of an amount that we did not bring to council under your financial policy. But change orders three, four, five, and six are above that, although relative to the whole project, they are still a small percentage. The four of these change orders total amount of $417,765.73, which is again still less than what the second low bid would have been. The change orders are for the varying soil conditions that we found on this project. As you can imagine, when you're 20, 25 feet deep, we experienced everything. Two of the change orders are for where the contractor found very soft soils, and actually the soils had the groundwater was moving up in the soil profile, giving it a quicksand effect. And so the contractor, having experienced this before, recommended that they overexcavate and then backfill it with a riprap. And in discussion with other engineers and Terracon, we felt that that was the most economical solution for these softer soils. And then on the flip side of those, another one of the change orders is actually for bedrock excavation. So we went for both ends of the spectrum on this project. So that is change orders three through six. And again, the total of those three is around $418,000. I'm sorry, the total for those four is $418,000.
Three, four, five, and six.
Yep.
And that was just on the step one area, or was that including the change order to add what went on through the golf course?
That is the next action item, change order two. So yes, okay. this is just for the contract up to Lamps and Woods. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yes.
All right, I just want to make sure there's
okay
some differences there.
Yeah.
And what percentage of the, how close are we to completion on that step?
They have all the pipe in the ground, and they have tested it all, but some brave members of the sewer crew walked the 48-inch pipe Thursday, I believe. So it has
crunched down.
What? I think they used a skateboard.
Oh, yeah.
No, they hunched down.
No, they were bent over walking through the pipe the whole way.
Yeah.
I was up on top doing a visual.
Mike walked the 50.
You were creative, so like El Chapo. You would have had one of those little motorcycle deals where.
Exactly.
So the project, as far as pipe and materials, is 100% complete. They are doing fine.
Did you get that one?
They're doing the fine grading, and hopefully when the weather starts to turn warm again, they'll be working on the seating on that project. So done very efficiently, and could not be happier with this crew. And then when we see the compaction reports, is also seeing the way the T-log, the testing of the manholes and the pipe, everything's passed with flying colors, and we're all very happy with that portion.
Okay, thank you. Mel, do you have the financial number, the breakdown of all those four in on a list there? I know we've got them in each.
I can read them right before the motion.
Yeah.
Does that work? Okay.
Yeah.
So change order number three is for $183,768.15.
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Anderson, second by Flournoy. Questions? Any discussion? Please call the roll.
Anderson.
Yes.
Flournoy.
Yes.
Rasmussen.
Yes.
Hallie.
Yes.
Hamilton.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. And then moving into change order number four.
This is for $25,717.58.
Okay, motion to approve.
So moved.
Moved by Flournoy.
Second.
Second by Rasmussen. Discussion. Please call the roll.
Flournoy.
Yes.
Rasmussen?
Yes.
Hallie?
Yes.
Hamilton?
Yes.
Anderson?
Yes.
All right, thank you. Move on to change order number five.
$117,381.08.
Okay. Entertain a motion to approve.
So moved.
Moved by Flournoy?
Second.
Second by Anderson. Discussion? Please call the roll.
Flournoy?
Yes.
Anderson?
Yes.
Rasmussen?
Yes.
Hamilton?
Yes.
Hallie?
Yes.
Okay. And finally, change order number six.
$74,877.84.
Okay. So moved.
Moved by Flournoy to approve.
Second.
Second by Rasmussen.
Would like to ask a question about this one.
Mm-hmm.
Can you explain this one a little bit more? Either Mike or Melanie?
Number six.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Additional cost as a result of not being able to secure material without a signed contract?
There is a provision in the contract that I've never seen as an issue, but it's a part of rural development that was not aware of, and it allows the contractor to request additional cost if the contract is not returned within 60 days. And it was not returned within 60 days. His original request was for a lump sum of 5%, which was nearly double this amount. And once we talked with him as far as where his actual increased material cost, it was primarily the steel for the casing under Highway 34. And then also he cut out his overhead and profit on that increased amount. So we're satisfied with how it was taken down after some discussion.
This is at cost.
Yes.
What caused that delay in getting the return contract?
Mike?
A variety of factors. I think one of the things, this is our first time going through the USDA legal review process. Melanie and I were both in conversation with the contractor at multiple points through that review process, saying that the city will award, that he could order his pipe. At no time was there ever a lack of communication with the contractor. However, he would not order his pipe until the city executed that contract. And unfortunately, this is a result, steel prices went up and fiberglass prices went up, and he's passing that along as he can through the provisions of the contract.
So there was just a learning curve in
the process. Absolutely.
Okay. Thanks.
Any other questions, Council? We have a motion, a second. Please call the roll.
Flournoy?
Yes.
Rasmussen?
Yes.
Anderson?
Yes.
Hamilton?
Yes.
Hallie?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. And then we'll move on to consideration of change order number 2, and this is with Langham Construction. That does involve golf course. Yes.
So Langman is the addition to step one through the golf course. And as we discussed when that project was bid, that we were still negotiating with the Skevich as far as the route through that property. And so when we got to that point, and we discussed it in closed session as far as how we were going to proceed. So this is the change order for the work through the Skevich property. Again, real happy with the prices. Several of the items were at or even below the bid price that he had given us before. The estimate that I had given you in closed council for the or closed session for this work was $136,000. So, he was right there where I was expecting it to see. Again, this is change order number 2. Change order number 1 was for $7,901. I'll admit there's been enough work going on. I can't remember exactly what that was for, but again, it was within your financial policy to sign that and not take that one in front of council. So this change order amount is for $130,954.15. Some of these items are a unit price, such as 300 lineal feet of 36-inch sanitary sewer. So if they put in $299, we pay them for that amount, not the amount on the change order.
Okay, thank you, Melanie. Questions, any council, any questions on this change order?
This change order completes the project along the south side of the golf course, as well as what's left on Yuskevich's property to connect with the South Main sewer project that we did a few years ago, correct?
Mostly, and the reason I hesitate is because of using the existing easement, this sewer that is getting built now will have to tie into an existing manhole. Mm-hmm. And because the sewer can't be online until the plant is up and running, 18 months from now when the plant is up and running, there'll be about 100 feet of pipe to connect this to the manhole. It's relatively shallow, 6 to 8 feet deep, whether the city would decide to do it in-house or hire someone to do that little bit. But that's, it's very similar to some of the other things that have to be done in order to
make
the final connection. But to answer your question, yes, it is the last section to connect to South Main with this little bit to do the final connection.
Good.
Okay, glad you understood that.
Thank you.
Okay, then I entertain a motion to approve change order number 2 for Langham Construction.
Move to approve.
Second.
Moved by Hamilton, second by Flournoy. Please call the roll.
Hamilton?
Yes.
Flournoy?
Yes.
Anderson?
Yes.
Hallie?
Yes.
Rasmussen?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
I was going to ask for an update on
D Street. Yeah, I didn't give an update on this project. Mr. Holly asked about D Street. As far as I'm aware, D Street is still closed. They've successfully crossed D Street with the sewer, but I believe they're still hauling dirt in and out and getting Yuskevich property shaped and cleared. And so I think until they feel like they're farther away from D Street, they're going to keep it closed. I'll have a better update later this week. On the, as far as that project, Langman is through the golf course with laying pipe and setting the manholes. They will start their testing of it, part of on this size pipe, because we can't get anyone to walk through the 36 inch. They will videotape it. So they'll be doing that over the next couple weeks, as well as other testing that's typical of the sanitary sewer. And I know with the nice weather, everyone's anxious to have that project wrapped up, but even though all the pipe's in the ground, there's still some work to be done that's not as obvious as digging the pipe. But again, very happy with their progress. They'll make their completion date.
Great. Thank you, Melanie. Appreciate that. Next, council, we'll move on to approval or consideration of approval for workforce housing tax incentive program application. Mike, would you explain to the council what we're approving here?
Absolutely, Mayor. Thank you. Basically, we're redoing what we've already done for the second half of Martin Brett's North Campus Village Phase 5 housing project. In the first application, Martin applied for about 28 units. He was unsure of the scope of the project at that time. It's been very successful for him. So we, as a body, are basically saying we're giving continued support to the project as we agreed to do in our economic development agreement with Mr. Brett.
Okay. Thank you, Mike.
You're welcome.
Entertain a motion then to approve the support for the workforce housing tax incentive program for North Campus Village Phase 5.
So moved.
Moved by Anderson, second by Rasmussen. And all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed, the same sign. Thank you. Council, at our last meeting, we looked at the list of delinquent utility accounts and asked if we could go back and look to be sure that these weren't people who had accounts that were still property owners within the city, so that we could potentially assess those to their property as we do with our nuisance abatement. And Joy, if you'd report what we found, please.
Yeah, Mindy called over to the assessor's office, and there were just no properties owned at all on the 7 accounts. I mean, I think it's on your list. One of them was a couple of them were out of business. The other, there was no property. So they are delinquent and old, and hopefully we can just write them off.
Okay. Thank you, Joy. Mm-hmm. Council, what is your wish?
I move that we approve.
Okay. Move to approve the delinquent accounts as a write-off by Flournoy.
Second.
Second by Rasmussen. Any other discussion? Now, please call the roll.
Flournoy.
Yes.
Rasmussen.
Yes.
Anderson.
Yes.
Hamilton.
Yes.
Hallie.
Yes.
Great. Thank you. Council, the next four resolutions, which are essentially ratifying easements that we have already kind of discussed and approved, is not ready for this evening, so we will table these four until our next meeting. We'll see those four again. So entertain a motion to table the consideration for the ratifications of easements on your agenda.
I move we table those four resolutions.
Okay. Moved
second.
By Flournoy.
Second.
Second by Anderson. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed, the same sign. Thank you. Council, I have a new appointment to propose to the Beautification Commission. That is Melanie Welb. Melanie is of Green Building Supply, has spoken with the committee, is interested in joining their efforts, and this is an open position. Entertain a motion to approve Melanie.
So moved.
Moved by Anderson.
Second.
Second by Rasmussen. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, the same sign. Thank you. That is all I had to report. We'll move then to our committee reports. Property committee, Darren.
You'll find a link to chapter 20.76 for signs in your tablet. The link shows some highlighted areas in this document. On page 3, we begin with correcting a typo. At the bottom of the page in section J, previously read 2.76.100. It should have been 20.76.100.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so that's where we are starting simply. We get a little more complex when we get to page 5 of our document. Top of page 5 would be motorists or pedestrians and or curb disturb the peaceful enjoyment with that particular line. Mm-hmm. Underneath that, we are proposing to remove the section that describes the downtown area. Previously, the ordinance was tied to the Fairfield Cultural District. I have given you all a map that looks like this. The red line shows the area of the cultural district. The yellow highlighted and hashed portion shows what is now to be considered the downtown area. Okay, and wording that pertained to the cultural district has been changed with downtown area throughout the entire document, thanks to Michael Halley for making it a Word document that's searchable and find and replaceable and all of these good things. The description of that area, I changed that a little bit from what was initially proposed so that we were in line with what we had previously stated the area was. We described streets east and west, north, south, sides, right or left. And then the south to north streets for the cultural district. So I patterned the description of the downtown area to coincide with that in a similar way, so that there is no confusion that if you're going down Washington Avenue from 2nd to B, you're only going to be on the north side of the street, that you're able to have signs that we're describing here. And on the south side, you're not restricted from that.
Okay.
So that's an example of what that change was all about. Moving on to what would be page 6 in that document. We, in chapter 2076050, prohibited signs, section 5, portable signs defined as those with wheels pulled by a vehicle in the downtown area, as defined in 2076030, number 2, parent E only, which refers back to that new downtown area that we have now described. On page 7, we have a similar type insertion, the downtown area as defined in 2076030. So that would be in item number 9, signs with bare bulbs illumination. And then on page 11, we have 2076100, and I might ask Mr. Halley to review this a little bit.
Sure.
With us to explain more about what we did with this area.
All right, this harkens back to the change that we made to blade signs last year. And last year we defined blade signs as not being able to be or allowed to be self-illuminated or lit from within. We have several signs in our downtown that are technically blade signs or projecting signs that are illuminated. So we modified this section to allow for either or. So a business on a first floor may have a projecting sign. They may have a non-internally illuminated blade sign, mm-hmm. or an internally illuminated projecting sign. One or the other, not both. And then for second floor establishments, they may have one or other, but not both, located slightly higher in the building. So it fits the spirit of what we were doing last year, but it also encompasses many of the signs that we already have in our downtown that we would not want to then force those property owners to replace at potentially significant cost. So it's kind of broadens the scope of those types of signs that project from the building, one or the other, either illuminated from within or not, is basically the amendment.
So the committee has recommended that we bring these changes to the council, and I believe it's the committee's wish to have the current version of chapter 20.76 be repealed, and then the new version, which you received in your packet with the yellow highlighting, replace that. So I would propose that as a motion, that we repeal chapter 20.76 and replace it with this rewritten version of chapter 20.76 as the first to the second reading.
Okay, so you know, we are changing this by ordinance, and are we okay to do that, John, based on what's been presented in our agenda for this evening?
I think you'll be okay as long as you have a public hearing on one of your next two readings.
Right, okay. Okay, that's fine, and I think at this point in time, since we are doing that, I will call for a public hearing, just in case there is someone
sure.
here who would like to speak on it. So at this point in time, before we take this action, I would open this up for a public hearing and ask if there is any public comment. Okay, not seeing any at this time, we'll close the public hearing, and then we will, so the repeal we'll take separately, mm-hmm. And that would be for, again, section?
Would be chapter 20.
Chapter 20.76. Okay. Entertained. So we have a motion to repeal from Hamilton. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Hallie. Please call the roll.
Hamilton?
Yes.
Hallie?
Yes.
Rasmussen?
Yes.
Anderson?
Yes.
Flournoy?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Then the next, Darren, would be a motion to move as amended what you've presented this evening through the first,
from the first
to the second reading.
Mm-hmm.
Moved by Hamilton.
Second.
Second by Flournoy. Any discussion? Not please call the roll.
Hamilton?
Yes.
Flournoy?
Yes.
Anderson?
Yes.
Rasmussen?
Yes.
Hallie?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Next, we'll move to the Water and Sewer Utilities Committee. Doug, do you have?
Yeah, we had a very brief meeting tonight just before our council meeting. We had one request for a sewer adjustment, which was turned down because all the water had gone down the drain inside the house. So that's all the action we took.
Okay, thank you for your report. Next, we'll move to our department reports. Chief Thomas, you have a report on bus safety.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I apologize. I will try to look up. I promised my crew I would stick to the notes or I'll forget something for sure. This last week, we did, with the thanks, big help to the media, we did a media blitz. The reason we're discussing bus safety tonight is we were contacted by our prosecutor's office. Mr. Pat McAvan, who does a lot of our prosecutions, saw a huge increase this year. His quote to me today was he's seen bus violations this year in the amount that he's seen in the last 3 years combined. So it's tripled this year. So we're kind of looking at why we have such an increase in bus violations. By and large, we're seeing a huge increase on Burlington Avenue, specifically in the 2500 block of West Burlington, the 600 block of West Burlington, and the 300 block of East Burlington. I'm sure it's just where the stops are, probably on Burlington. But of course, we know that a lot of the violations are not necessarily intentional, although they are dangerous. But because it's happening on there, we're asking what we can do to improve. And a lot of it's just public education. That's why I'm kind of talking tonight about this, to reiterate it again in this public hearing. We've also talked to the bus staff and asked why are we seeing a huge increase, and they're saying there are a lot of different routes at different times. Back 10 years ago, most folks assumed it was morning or night is the only time you saw the bus. They have afternoon routes. They have noontime routes where they're seeing buses stop and vehicles aren't really paying attention and going on around them. The prosecutor that's had to talk to the poor folks that are cited for this wanted me to tell you that at least tell the public he's concerned because a minimum fine in Iowa for the first offense is $250 and a maximum is $675. So it's an expensive fine. We have assigned officers to actually follow school buses around. So we're hoping, but we'd rather do a more public education than the officer actually having to write. It's one of the few offenses in Iowa that's a mandatory ticket, which state lawmakers give discretion to police officers on almost every citation, with the exception of a few, and school bus violations are one. That's how important it is to the state of Iowa. We're required, if we identify who's operating the vehicle, that we have to issue a citation and they have to go to court. It's mandatory appearance required. So we're out trying to address it. The only thing we're asking is, it was my kid actually came home and told me this, Pat McAvan and I have discussed it, and they're teaching it in driver's ed, and sometimes we forget, I understand, but quite frankly, they say if you see a bus anywhere, you have to assume that it's going to stop. And if you're not for sure, please, please, please stop. Our kids' safety is at risk, and especially on Burlington, we do have kids crossing Burlington, and people think because there's three lanes they can go ahead and proceed, or if they just don't understand, they go ahead and pass the school bus going the other way. That is a violation, and it's dangerous. I do appreciate the time. Hopefully this will help.
No, I think that's fine, Chief. You know, it is a little surprising, a little alarming. I think most people would agree that your first thought when you see the back of a bus is, is this bus going to stop? Let me be prepared for what this bus is going to do. And I think most people don't even take chances with that as well, in terms of, well, let me beat it before it stops or something like that. There's generally a lot of leeway given to what's going on. So it's a little surprising to see that is up. I guess on Burlington, it doesn't surprise me. Depends on the time of day. There's a frustration with the fact that there's only one lane of traffic. I get that. And then sounds like they may be using that middle lane as a passing lane and figuring that they're probably okay in a passing lane. So I think maybe that's where the education piece needs to come from, is that people need to understand that although that is a turning lane, it's not a passing lane.
And that's greatly appreciated, and I appreciate you saying it, because that is the information we're trying to get out.
Right.
Okay. Hopefully several are listening tonight.
Can you clarify, though, if I were traveling the opposite direction and the opposite lane is the bus, but it stopped and put its sign out, I stop.
Exactly.
So that's the thing. You're not even behind a bus.
It's true.
If it stops, you're going the other way, you stop.
Right.
And we're kind of scratching our heads because people realize on the three lane that if it's an emergency vehicle, our police officers are telling me, and the firefighters and the EMS folks are saying they're stopping for emergency vehicles traveling the opposite direction. Hmm. But for some reason on the three lane, they think it's okay if the bus stops completely on the other side, that they can continue. And I think the mayor is right. Some people are just in a hurry and they're in doubt, so they just go ahead and slowly go past, and it's definitely a violation.
Yeah, I think what they're perceiving, you're right, I think it's a good example. They're perceiving that it's a divided highway situation, and it's really not.
Definitely
not.
Yeah,
got it.
Well, okay. The other question I have is, why is there such a dramatic uptick this year than there was in the 3 to 5 years that this has been in place out there on Burlington? Why now this year is everybody kind of ignoring what had been going on for this long a time period?
We're kind of looking at it. We think our bus staff is getting better with technology. They're making more cases for the prosecutor. A lot of times we were getting reports, half report or half plates of reports. The difference is now, thanks to cell phones, and our bus drivers have figured out for violators going past, they're taking a quick picture instead of having to see the license plate. They can review, and it's great evidence in court. We're seeing more and more. So we think our bus crews are getting better at protecting the kids with the technology they have. So that was one, because that was exactly the question we asked. Why did this increase this year as opposed to last year? And it's just our
documentation.
Technology's out there to take a picture quickly, and they're getting us full plates, vehicle description, and a nice picture of the driver as they go past.
It sounds like that's the most important information to get out there, is that you can get caught, and you will get caught.
Now, there was a diagram put out by the Department of Transportation just recently about bus passing. Is that going to be in the newspaper again?
Mr. Halley was nice enough to put that nice on the Facebook, and I think that visual led to 2,000 plus hits last time I checked. It's incredible.
It's a nice visual.
It seems to draw attention. Dave with the radio station, I was talking to him before, they've talked for 2 days straight last week when we did our media release. So we're getting it out there, and hopefully some education, talking to the public. And education with, we like the positive education. The negative education is what I talked to Mr. McAvan today. Everybody that's cited, he says, tell your friends, don't end up in court like you did. Right. Spread the word. We're trying to get it out there.
Yes. Okay. Well, thank you, Chief, and thank you, Council, for your comments. And we are concerned for the safety of our school children using the buses. So hopefully that will start to diminish. That takes us to the end of our business in open session. We do have some business in closed session to go into. So at this time, I entertain a motion to go into closed session according to Iowa Code 21.5J in our discussion over real estate matters.
So moved.
Moved by Anderson.
Second.
Second by Hamilton. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, the same sign. Okay, thank you.